So, hello everyone. As the title says, today's presentation is you might want to move a bit over this. How to be a successful youth orchestra musician. How do we know? Because we think we were successful, we were definitely a youth orchestra.
The first rule of being a musician is you gotta learn how to improvise, and case in point, right now, we have this presentation.
And Jordan just showed up, right?
All right, cool. That's me. Well, at least it was when I was three. That's when I started playing violin, and I started doing YOSA when I was in third grade. It was just 1 year. That was kind of weird. And then the last 6 years, I've been in consecutively. And I'll be going to the University of Alabama on Friday. That's starting. Yeah. 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 All right, yeah, I'll be in the University Orchestra and such.
Space Force.
If I'm on, do you have any idea how to full screen that?
Hi, my name is Dave Menchaca. I'm going to be a junior at Trinity University this coming fall. I've been in the YOSA family for 9 years, and once I left for college, I've also been helping out with extra little stuff as well. And like I said, I'm studying English and music there at Trinity, and I'm considering being either a music professor, English professor,
or Hello, I'm Federico Chavez-Torres, but as the highlighting indicates, you can just call me Fed. That's a YOSA photo. I hope they'll get mad at me for taking that one. I've been in Chalice and YOSA for about 6 years. Alex and I have been, for as long as I've been in YOSA, we've been together. We played for the last 4 years. I'm going to UT next year for engineering. Well, I guess not next year, it's in 2 weeks. Oh my god. For engineering, I'll be in the engineering orchestra. And I hope to be an entrepreneur in space.
And there's a quick little picture of us when we that was maybe freshman year, I hope. So,
yeah, those times have passed. So, the first step to being successful is listening to music. Now, who actually listens to music, right? So, what does that even mean, listening to music? So, there's active listening and there's passive listening. I'm glad that most of you guys are actively listening because I can tell by your body language. But for the most part, we passively listen to things. So we're on the radio, and we're just bumping our speakers, whatever it is you're listening to. And it sounds good. We're enjoying it. Our head is bobbing. But then there's active listening. So in order to illustrate this example, we're going to use Kendrick Lamar's Humble?
Yes.
Yes.
Humble. Yes.
We're going to use Humble. And we're going to listen to it passively first. Alex?
Nobody pray for me. Am I not there for me? Yeah, yeah.
So, passively, you guys were all just really jamming out, we saw definitely over there, y'all were jamming over there. We were all passively listening, but if you were actively listening, there's a big difference between the two. Actively listening, you look at it and you're like, man, why does it sound just so meaty? And then you realize, it's in A-flat minor, that's why. And then, Kendrick Lamar's Humble Symphony, number one in A-flat minor. Yeah, and then you do a little more thinking, you're like, oh, the hi-hat isn't always consistent. Active versus passive, and you definitely need to learn how to actively listen if you want to be a successful youth orchestra musician.
The next step is listen with your part, right? So you're enjoying everything, it's all good. Then get your part in front of you, and instead of having to guess it's an A-flat minor, you can actually look at the key signature. There's no guessing involved. Whatever's on your sheet is what you're listening to. So when you can make that connection, you know you're playing the notes right. And once you know you can play the notes right, you can play them however you want. I don't know why I just... Oh yeah, make notes. Yes, make notes. Sorry. Make notes. So if you realize I wasn't playing the crescendo, or maybe I was playing a wrong note, just simple things like that. But you can go even deeper just to listening. Listen for the horns maybe, because we're lazy. We don't always want to count. Another thing you can move on to is orchestral karaoke. So just like karaoke, you just get one of these speakers, or whatever you have, your headphones, and get your instrument out, and you play along. It sounds a little silly, a little unorthodox for sophisticated classical music, but come on, you can do it. And one thing, very important, let it stick, chew on it, right? If a piece of music sounds good, it sounds good no matter how you look at it. So always make, as long as you're in love with the music and you like what you're playing and you're excited to go to the orchestra and play whatever that part you keep singing, that's really where the passion and the love will start to come out. So does that even help? Yes, it does.
Anyone,
who reads music and jokes? Okay, cool. Anyone want to sightsee this?
No. Oh, I studied this, and I'm not sightseeing that.
Does anybody want to do that?
No.
Alex is going to use his musical powers. You don't have to suffer. So that always works. It didn't work.
You don't need to suffer by reading a B sharp. I'm sorry.
I mean, it's like in school.
You're active listening, guys. But for the most part, would you think that would work? Okay.
I mean, that's probably the most extreme example that we could find. It actually was.
Dude, when you got the choir knowledge,
yes.
Who does that?
Take
it away.
So, when you're in orchestra, you'll just learn. There's three main types of knowledge about an orchestra. You'll learn like some historical stuff. So you'll learn about Shostakovich, how he had to appeal to the Soviets, but low-key he was dissing them. Another 1812 overture doesn't even have to do anything with the United States. It's talking about the Napoleonic retreat from Moscow. And then this musical thing, like, who has drawn that? Who has like?
I have. If you've played it with like an orchestra.
Yeah, they're like draw little glasses like five measures before
you're supposed to. I gotta put my glasses.
It always happens like that. There's all sorts of musical information too, right?
Yeah, like play at the Frog. Okay, that's you know really string. We're all string players, so that was really something that we were putting this.
Play at the Frog doesn't sound like a name that makes much sense as you.
It does. Like
yeah, you got to play at the very bottom end of the bow. Yeah,
you know, just like stuff like, oh, that's a G sus chord. You just kind of learn it, you know. Oh, okay, a little more. That was in A flat minor. You just bullshit like that. then going on, we learn plenty of other things that just aren't musical, aren't historical. Like how to properly bow. Troy Peters, I remember he giving us a lecture on when we bow, you have to look down at your toes and say, "There is an elephant standing on my shoes," and then stand back up. That's how you do it. That's how we taught us.
Tell me that.
Taught us. Might have been more recent than David's like 2 years older than us, so that's why.
Yeah.
Well, not all the stuff the same. All right, and then like always match your shoes to your belt. There was a big lecture on that one day after a concert, and so yeah, there was that. And then you know like stuff like the Purple Rain album is the reason explicit content is on. Stuff. We had played Purple Rain live, some of us did. Did you?
I did not. Exactly.
The two of us did, and you know, that was an awesome time. We got into a bunch of y'all, like, not just to the two of us. And like one thing he told us is like when we were playing Darling Nikki, he's like, hey, this song's the reason that explicit content is on albums that come out in the US. If you listen to the song, trust me, you'll know it like about 30 seconds in.
I think we should actively listen to that.
Should we? I think you can do that pretty passively.
So let's talk about knowledge. Here's the pros and cons list for knowledge. So let's just talk about pros before we move on to the cons. So when you learn things, especially music, perspective is everything and just everything. But in music, it's very cool when you can have a different perspective. So I like, for example, I'm American playing a piece that's not American. And then I learned a little something about on the other side, that helps me play the piece a little bit better.
That's true. That's beneficial just to the execution, you know, just like so you can imagine when you become more knowledgeable, you can, as you have that new perspective, you can play things better. You're like, okay, well, you know, it's written this way, but if you're playing an American piece, you know, in America you do this. But if you're playing a German piece, they crescendo differently and stuff like that. And, you know, that goes back to cultural awareness, next point. And that just really helps out overall because you can appreciate a whole lot more with that.
And it might answer any questions you have, like just like why is there like this weird part in the middle, and it just might be like the composer was high or something like that.
And then of course those answers you like more questions. Yeah. And that's always the best part about learning, ain't it?
So third final step in this presentation is to make friends. And who makes friends? So let's talk about the pros and cons of making friends.
Once again, we'll start with the pros, we'll get to the cons later.
So you get to talk about the music with them. So I'm blessed with a family musician, so I can talk to my dad and my sister about things. but some people aren't. So you might just be geeking out about something, and there's like you can't really go like, hey, mom, Pumple's in A flat minor or something. Like that. I'm just gonna keep going back to that. So when you have friends, you can text them and be like, yo, listen to this, like fire emojis, and it can be something. And then you also have people to play music with, so like Victoria and Dominic. They were in Yosa. At one point, they never talked to each other, but one day they did. And now we have 16 psyche.
There were no other steps in the process.
Or you're like, someone's like, I need someone to play my wedding, and you're looking to make some change. You know a couple talented musicians who are working
together. And handsome.
Gotta give him something to see a little.
Yeah, my dad hired him to play at my sister's wedding.
Does he do that awesome?
And of course, you can also make numerous other connections as well. For instance, now I know where to go if I want to perform an indie rock set at the Mansion, Books and Records, if only it didn't take me a whole year to write a 3-minute song.
And I think one of the best things about having friends is you can learn from them. Because hopefully you have a very diverse friend group and you guys are all pretty close together. Alex's upbringing is very different from mine. And we learn from each other just in the way we look at things, the way we talk about things, the way we go about things. That's also very cool.
That was a couple few things that are.
Oh, yeah. Friendly competition.
Friendly competition.
Yeah.
He and I were in the same orchestra. What was that? My 7th grade year. You were like first chair as a freshman in high school.
Yeah.
And I looked at that and I'm like, wow, I need to meet that.
Victoria over here was the same way. Like, yeah. Joe said, like, I'm gonna take down David someday. And 3 years later, I thought, oh, I should finally did.
You're just looking around, and you know, you're always trying to beat other people. At least I am. I'm a very competitive person, and you know,
I'm more competitive.
Precisely. I'm sure a bunch of you know about potential collaborators. You just get with, like, we met each other in, you know, orchestra, and that's how we've, you know, we collab all the time, like we did. Like, we'll just go over to my house and just jam out. Or, you know, like my dad with my sister's wedding, both of us were hanging out, and that's how we did. That's how we ended up playing that gig. And then, you know, friends, as you all know, I can't believe I'm giving a lecture on friendship. About an hour passed down time. You know, I go to college in 3 days. I'm not going to be giving up my friends. They're going to still be there. And yeah. Lifeline, you know, he needed a ride here. I gave it to him.
I mean, you're friends. This is what friends do. So the big concept here is that it's all connected. Like, in order to be a successful musician, like, don't even think about your instrument. Don't even think about the rehearsal. Think of it. It starts before you even walk in. Listening to music, making friends, having people to talk to, having people to bounce ideas off of. And, of course, being attentive and being a careful learner. That doesn't even involve playing your instrument, unless, like, talk about the karaoke part. But it doesn't even involve playing your instrument, right? Because, for the most part, we all just listen to music. And if you can go back to that when you're listening to music, and what made it special, and you can apply it to when you actually play, it'll help you become a better musician, and it'll help the overall goal of the orchestra, which is to make beautiful, beautiful, beautiful music. So with that in mind, thank you guys very much. Our virtual doors are open to you at these internet locations.
I can't believe this.
Do we have any time for questions? 3 or 2 questions?
Sure.